Captain, there's a storm approaching.
A storm? Grab the anchor, Mr. Bogley.
Aye, sir.
Head for the shallows. Jack, hoist down the anchor. It'll keep the currents from making us go adrift, Mr. Bogley.
Aye, sir. There's many things in life that can distract us and move us and make us go adrift, sir, but we have an anchor for our soul.
Yes, we do. His name is Jesus Christ. And today we're going to take a look. Do you have an anchor for your soul?
I mean, this is an exciting series, an exciting topic, but where's the adventure in the anchor? It just plops on the bottom of the ocean, and there it sits, right? All those nautical terms that you think about, and there's so many of those things. Pastor Cody preached a couple weeks ago, and he brought up this thing called a chip block. What? Where did they come up with these things, right? But if you Google it, the list seems endless of nautical terms. There's things like yard, sheet, stays, shrouds, brace, a lee, abaft, avast, booms, beam, cannon, cables, sloops, skiffs, skyscrapers, bowers, and bosuns. Right? Just Google it. The list goes on and on. But that great contraption, that thing made of steel, that thing of iron hanging on the side of the ship, I'm like, man, of all the things I get to talk about, it's that. Right? How many of you ever heard that old Christian cliche? If you're not moving forward, you're moving backwards. Right, and I thought about it, and I said, well, you know, when the ship is firmly anchored in the harbor, it's definitely not moving forward. Of course, it's definitely not moving backward either, and that's exactly why a ship needs an anchor. Our scripture for this morning indicates that there is an anchor for us as well, an anchor for our souls. This morning, I'd like to discuss with you that why, like a great sailing ship, we need an anchor as well. Not to keep us in some spiritual harbor per se, but to provide us with three things that we need when the proverbial storms of life come along. And I can assure you, those storms will come. You see this thing I'm, oh, I'm sorry. You see this thing I'm wearing here? It's a mobile defibrillator in case my heart goes into a dangerous arrhythmia. It's not an anchor, but it's a daily reminder to me that a storm can strike at a moment's notice. And let me tell you, if you're not securely anchored to the Savior, you can enter into dangerous waters. So let's get to it straight away, shall we? There's a few things that an anchor provides that we want to talk about today. They are safety, security, and hope. But before we can talk about these things, we have to understand what exactly our spiritual anchor is. We know that a ship uses an enormous anchor made of steel or iron to maintain its position, but we don't. I mean, can you imagine if each Sunday you walked in here carrying an anchor? You walked in, chose your seat, dropped it on the floor. Imagine how noisy that would be, and quite frankly, we'd probably be replacing the carpet about every 3 months. But worse than that, at the end of our services, Pastor Matt would stand and he would dismiss us. And all of a sudden, everybody would have to adopt their best Pirates of the Caribbean voices. All right, weigh anchor. Put your backs into it, you scurvy dogs. I've got to get to lunch, and Longhorn's having a sale on shrimp today. Right? And everybody would be dragging their anchors out, throwing them in the back of the car, and racing off to Longhorn for some shrimp and steak, right? So let's clear this up. We're going to go to our scripture, which is Hebrews chapter 6. We're going to be reading verses 13 through 19, or 13 through 20. If you could turn there in your Bibles, that would be great. That's Hebrews chapter 6, verses 13 through 20. You know, Pastor Matt is trying to drag me into the 21st century. I don't do slides. I don't do movie clips. I don't do any of that stuff. And last week he was furiously texting me, "Hey, Dave, if you need any slides, I can make them up for you." I'm like, oh, no, I don't need that. And I'm thinking, well, maybe I should. So, of course, he got me here into the 21st century. We have four slides, and we have a little film clip today, right? So, but it's all because of Pastor Matt, not because of me, right? If it was left up to me, you'd be suffering through the 18th century preaching. Hebrews chapter 6, verses 13 through 20. For when God made a promise to Abraham, since he had no one greater by whom to swear, he swore by himself, saying, surely I will bless you and multiply you. And thus Abraham, having patiently waited, obtained the promise. For people swear by something greater than themselves, and in all their disputes, an oath is final for confirmation. So when God desired to show more convincingly to the heirs of the promise the unchangeable character of his purpose, he guaranteed it with an oath, so that by two unchangeable things in which it is impossible for God to lie, we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor for the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. You know, most people, when they read a book, they read it from the beginning to the end, left to right, if you will. But, you know, there's always those rebels who want to read the last chapter first. They just can't wait to find out what happens in the end. Well, we're not going to do exactly that today, but what we're going to do, instead of going through each verse systematically, we're going to just go through the whole thing all at once, one big chunk of scripture, so that we can have an understanding of what our topic is for today. The author brings us all the way back to the days of Abraham and speaks of the great promises of God to him, in which God promised him land, descendants, and that all the families of the earth would be blessed through Abraham's lineage. And then the author explains, when people want to be emphatic about a promise, they swear by something greater than themselves. Kind of like when we say, I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help me God. Our scripture indicates the truth that there is nothing higher than God, and that he guaranteed his promise with an oath. The scriptures also affirm that it is impossible for God to lie. And then the author brings us up to the time of when he was writing, to whom he was writing. He says, we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement to hold fast to the hope set before us. What is this hope? The answer lies in the last two verses of our scripture this morning, verses 19 and 20. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Our spiritual anchor consists of the reassurances from God, his promises and oath of everlasting life made available by Jesus' death on the cross for our sins, and his resurrection. The promise of everlasting life for us if we will believe, if we will have faith in this promise, which provides for us an everlasting hope. Yes, the author was indeed speaking to Hebrew Christians who were struggling in their faith at the time. But this scripture is also written for every believer who will come and read this scripture until the return of our great Savior, Jesus Christ. Our anchor, then, is the hope in the finished work of Jesus on the cross. Our anchor is the hope of the finished work of Jesus on the cross for us. Titus 2, verses 13 through 14. Waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. Why did Jesus do it? He did it for God's glory, and he did it for our good. Now that we've established what or who our anchor is, let's get back to what our anchor provides for us. Safety, security, and hope. The company I work for has a motto, safety first, so let's start there. When a great ship enters a harbor and decides to anchor offshore, the ship can be anchored in a couple of different ways. Two anchors attached to the bow can be set with a distance between them, and allowing the tides or the currents of the ocean to approach the bow. This keeps the ship from swaying as the tide passes by the ship, and the ship is held in place by the two anchors in the tide. Or an anchor can be deployed from both the bow and the stern. The stern anchor is called a bower, by the way. The results are the same in that the ship is kept from drifting while tethered to the anchor chains or ropes, which are also known as cables. The whole idea is to keep the ship, its crew, and cargo safe while riding at anchor. The ship will not drift with the wind or be driven onto rocks, shoals, reefs, or other ships. When the added precaution of safety lights are added, no other ship should run into the anchored vessel as well. Proverbs 18:10 tells us, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and they are safe. The implication is that when we have troubles or storms or difficulties, that we should turn to the Lord for his protection. If we do not employ the anchor that God has provided for us, we as Christians can drift as well. We can drift away from our faith. We are warned not to allow ourselves to drift away from the truth of the gospel in Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. That's Hebrews chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. Therefore, we must pay much closer attention to what we have heard, lest we drift away from it. For since the message declared by angels proved to be reliable, and every transgression or disobedience received a just retribution, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? How shall we escape indeed? David Wilkerson told the story of a man who drifted into a destructive lifestyle far away from God, whom he encountered during his ministry. A Broadway theater executive was especially rude to me during the time our ministry was negotiating to buy the Mark Hellinger Theater. I didn't really know the man, but he acted as if he could not stand to be near me, as if I had a contagious disease. He didn't even want to be in the same room with me. If we were walking somewhere, he would walk 10 feet in front of me. I was hurt by his actions, and I wondered why he singled me out for such cruelty. I thought, what is it about me that makes this man so nervous? I began to pray, and I set out to win his friendship. It took a while, but slowly he softened. One day, as we sat in a restaurant, he began to open his heart to me. And when he did, I was shocked to find out that he had had a powerful experience with Jesus Christ as a teenager. The Spirit had come upon him powerfully, and he had broken down weeping. He had heard the Lord say, "Give me your life." And he received a call to preach the gospel. After that, he had a caring heart for people and a true love for Jesus. But later, in his early 20s, he began to drift. He didn't turn his back on Jesus. He simply neglected him. He quit going to church, reading his Bible, and talking to the Lord. He buried himself in his work and ended up on Broadway, involved with theater celebrities. Eventually, he began to distance himself from his experience with Christ, and he began to drink heavily. His respect for the things of the Lord had lingered, but as he drifted farther away, it became easier for him to curse God and to mock other believers. When I came on the scene years later invading his world, it brought up all the old memories of church, God's word, Jesus, his calling. I was a reminder to him of what his life should have been, and he resented it. The last time I saw this man, he had lost his prestigious position. He was staggering past our church drunk. I had been a reminder to him and a rebuke, and now, in his need, he couldn't face it. The man had drifted. I'm sure it was slow at first, as David Wilkerson indicates. This slow drift can happen to any one of us, though. If we stop spending time in our Bibles, if we no longer attend church regularly, or we no longer desire to spend time with God's people, and lastly, fatally, if we do not spend time in prayer, communicating with our Heavenly Father. Folks, these are some of the dangers of drifting. It doesn't take long to go from being safely anchored by God's promises to feeling lost and hopeless if we neglect to study them and develop a deep, meaningful relationship with our Heavenly Father. There's another danger a ship can encounter while resting in a harbor or offshore. Once again, if not anchored securely, instead of a breeze pushing a ship into danger, a passing tide or current can pull a ship into obstructions, other boats, ships, or wharves. Just like the Japanese fishing vessel, the Ryu Unmaru, that was swept to sea in Japan when a tsunami hit that country in 2011. The Ruwan Maru was pulled by currents all the way across the Pacific Ocean. It took 1 year to cross the ocean, but the currents pulled it all the way across to the United States, where the U.S. Coast Guard eventually sunk it, rather than allowing the ship to do damage along the U.S. coastline. Like this ill-fated Japanese vessel, we too can be pulled along by different kinds of currents if we are not firmly anchored by the promises of God. The same currents that draw non-believers to their ill-fated end can exert a strong pull on our lives as well. How many times have you heard the cliche, just go with the flow? Christians, we have to fight against the flow of the world system. Folks, for our friends and neighbors and co-workers who do not know Christ as their Savior, they are a people who are not even aware of the current that is drawing them ever so gradually to their ultimate destruction. God forbid we go with the flow and allow them to think that there is no trouble ahead. God forbid we get caught up in the same destructive undertow ourselves. You know, when I was a little boy, my parents took my sisters and I to the beach. And I was so excited about it, spending the day with my family at the seashore, building sandcastles, exploring for shells and various sea creatures. But above all else, I really wanted to go swimming in the ocean. As we entered the waves, my dad told me, watch out for the undertow, son. You can be swept out to sea. Now, I had misheard my dad, and I thought he had said undertowed. Instead of enjoying looking for crabs and fish in the water, I was frantically searching for this mythical sea creature. A giant toad who just waited offshore to latch onto the ankle of a young, unsuspecting boy and drag him out to sea, never to be seen or heard from again. It's a true story. I don't like to go in water deeper than like right up to here. Look, I'm worried about that toad. He's still out there somewhere waiting. My son used to go deep, way out, much deeper, and he'd be like, come on, Dad. I'm like, no, the undertoad, he's gonna get you. Spiritually speaking, though, there is nothing going to grab us and jerk us to our deaths. But like the undertow of the ocean, there is a constant current or pull that on the surface is not even evident to our naked eye. At times, it's very mild, almost imperceptible. And sometimes it can be very strong, almost overwhelming as it pulls at us. So what are these currents? These are the things of the world. If we get caught up in them, we can get dragged toward a shipwrecked faith. The Bible, which was talked about this morning, in our word this morning, right? Right? That we could be, it was a warning. It's a warning not to get caught up in those things, and a promise that there is, God has given us an anchor to save us from those things as well. Amen? So, it can be very strong. The currents can be almost overwhelming if they pull at us. So, what are these currents? They are the things of the world. If we get caught up in them, we can be dragged toward a shipwrecked faith. The Bible identifies them for us like danger markers or buoys in a harbor or a channel. God has provided danger markers for us in his word. 1 John 2:16 provides one of those markers, one of those danger markers for us. It tells us, for all that is in the world, the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, the pride of life is not from the Father, but is from the world. The very things that the devil tried to tempt Jesus with in the wilderness are the same dangers that we can be tempted with as well, trying to suck us in and destroy us or render us ineffective for the kingdom. This next verse from the parable of the sower speaks to that very issue, how the cares of the world render us useless for the work of God that he intends for us. Matthew 13, verse 22. As for what was sown among the thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. This last verse is a clear warning, and if we notice ourselves being pulled into danger, we need to immediately grasp hold of our anchor and arrest our drift or our slide into dangerous waters. James 4:4, you adulterous people, do you not know what friendship with the world, that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. So often when we hear a message like this, we hear someone talking about hold the anchor, grasp the anchor, make sure we're firmly attached to the anchor. And you say to yourself, well, okay, great. How do I do that? How do I actually make sure I'm holding firmly to my anchor? Well, there is a place in Scripture. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn there. It was a word from Paul to Timothy. And he was telling Timothy how to grasp hold of that anchor and hold on to it firmly, and how important it was, and it is. I want to give you this advice from the Apostle Paul. Who better to receive? Where's Pastor Cody? Pastor Cody, right? Apostle Paul, who's he? He's the Mac Daddy of the New Testament, right? Remember that? I was paying attention. Amen? So let's get some advice from the Mac Daddy of the New Testament. Amen? 1 Timothy chapter 5, starting in verse 13. 1 Timothy chapter 5, starting in verse 13. We'll read 13, 15, and 16. Paul says, until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to exhortation, to teaching. Let me slip down to verse 15. Practice these things. Immerse yourself in them so that all may see your progress. Keep a close watch on yourself and on the teaching. Persist in this, for by so doing, you will save both yourself and your hearers. Folks, you want to know how to hold on to the anchor when all, you know, what's breaking loose all around you? Immerse yourself in the things of God. Reading His Word, praying, fellowshipping with other Christians. Right? Amen? Do those things. Immerse yourself in the things of God, and you will hold firmly, and your anchor will not fail you when you're in the worst storm of your life. Amen? The next benefit that we've been provided is security. There's that fabulous slide. Bam. Right? The next benefit is security. A great ship, while riding firmly at anchor in a harbor, is safe, but there's also a sense of security there. The danger of sea travels are all but eliminated. Enemy or pirate ships are discouraged from entering the port. The ship is protected from the ravages of storms, and provisions are readily accessible. Typically, a watch is posted and the ship is under guard. The crew can have a sense of security. They can rest easy as compared to their daily routine at sea. Even if a storm were to come while the ship is in port, it's been battened down, the ship, the sails are stored away, and the ship and the crew can ride out the storm feeling safe and secure. For the believer, our anchor provides us with similar benefits. Knowing that we are secure in our salvation allows us to rest in that. In other words, we do not have to worry. Our condition will not change. John 10:28, and I give to them eternal life, and they shall by no means perish forever, and no one shall snatch them out of my hand. No one shall snatch us out of his hand. Amen. Psalm 62:7 says, on God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Listen to those words again and think about the resolve with which this person, I'm assuming it was King David, I didn't check, felt as he was making this statement. On God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Amen. Do you get out of bed thinking that way? We should. Right, every day we should get out of bed having that kind of confidence, that kind of excitement about our salvation. When the storms of life come to us, knowing that our salvation is sure allows us to have a sense of security, even, as I said, even when all you know what is breaking loose all around us. Matthew 11:28 says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Psalm 62:6, he only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress, I shall not be shaken. There's someone resting in the promises. He's secure in the promises of God. We can be secure in the promises of God. The anchor provides safety, a sense of security, and the anchor provides hope. For the sailor, hope that when the winds and tides have done their best to shift the ship into precarious circumstances, that the ship will indeed be firmly anchored where it was moored the night before. That if a storm has come up, the ship is able to ride out the storm and will be ready to sail in the morning, and that the voyage can be completed. Now, most of you know that I've suffered a severe heart attack, and I'd like to tell you that throughout the whole thing, my faith never wavered, and that I held firmly to my spiritual anchor. But that wouldn't be quite the truth. The truth is, when it first started, I was in denial. But it didn't take long for reality to set in, and I called 911. As I lay on the couch waiting for the EMTs to arrive, I began to fear that I would not make it. The book of Ephesians tells us that the answer for worry is prayer. I'd like to tell you that as I lay there, I was boldly praying that you must know, though, that my prayers were not those of a mighty warrior. They were the prayers of a desperate man. Oh, God, help me. Please, I want to spend more time with my family. I want to see them again. I want to see my grandchildren grow up, and I want to dance at their weddings. When I was placed in the ambulance, everything sped up, right? The EMTs came and they got me. These folks are great at what they do. They stayed calm and did all the right things to arrest the damage being done to my heart. Once again, I'd like to say to you that my faith was a great witness for them, but I doubt it, as all I could do was ask questions and cry out, "Oh God, oh God, oh God." I was barely hanging on. As you know, the doctors were unable to install any stents. The blockage was too great. And the next day I was told that my heart function was reduced by 50%. The medical staff warned me that I would most likely go through a period of depression, that I would have to lose weight, 50 or 60 pounds, change my diet drastically, and exercise regularly if I wanted to survive. None of which I wanted to hear, by the way. Right? There was no quick fix, no quick surgery, no magic pill for me to take to make it all go away. But you know what? The storm had passed and the anchor had held. Diane was at my side throughout the whole ordeal. That night and the next day, there was a constant stream of friends and family. Pastor Matt, Greg, and Drew came down and they prayed for me. I had constant reassurances that I was being held up in prayer by you folks. And I can tell you, I could and can still feel the effects of your prayers. And I want to thank you. The storm in my life has not caused me to be depressed and drift away from God. It has not caused me to give up and allow myself to be dragged away from God. No, it has helped me to become more firmly anchored to the rock that is Jesus Christ. I now know that God is willing to use whatever it takes in my life for His glory and for my good. And He's willing to do the same thing for you. Oh, by the way, I went to my cardiologist this week. I had an echocardiogram, and guess what I found out? As Pastor Matt said earlier, only God can heal. My heart function has improved by 25%. I no longer need this thing. I no longer need to be shocked back from a dangerous arrhythmia. Amen? And that's all because of God. Hallelujah. I'd like to tell you too, though, that had my heart function not improved, my anchor would still hold. My anchor is still there. And He will not change, as we talked about earlier during our worship time. Amen? He's still great. He's still a God who deserves all the glory. And He still has our good at heart when things happen in our lives, when those storms come. Amen? Amen? Amen. So, folks, we're on a voyage, right? We're on a voyage that must be completed, though. There are uncertainties as we face our travels. How long will the journey last? Or when will we arrive at our final destination, who we will meet as we move from port to port, the exact course that will be followed. But we can be sure of one thing as we travel this journey of life. It is that we are not the first ones to travel this way. As a matter of fact, there is one who has gone before us in order that we would have hope in the final outcome of our journey. Hebrews 6:19-20 reveals who this was. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of our soul, a hope that enters into the inner place behind the curtain, where Jesus has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, having become a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Jesus led the way. He is our high priest, a high priest that will last forever. He entered into the Holy of Holies and bids us to come. Remember that list of nautical terms I read from the introduction? There's one I didn't mention. It is called the van. Van is short for vanguard, in the lead. There's one. In the days of sail, when Lord Nelson commanded the English Navy, the fleet would maneuver to gain the weather gauge, which was a position where one warship or fleet could attack or retreat at will because they had the wind at their advantage. From this upwind position, the ship with the weather gauge could attack or retreat at will. The fleet would fall into line, one ship behind the other. The ship that led the fleet into battle was called the van. It was a great honor for a captain and his crew to be named the van, but it was also very dangerous because they would take the most punishment as the enemy poured endless rounds of cannon fire into this lead ship. Let's take a look at this clip from the movie Master and Commander, and you could see just how dangerous and destructive a battle at sea was in the great days of sail.
Asheron,
sir.
You have no possibility, no chance, but you have heard warning. Stop now, or we will destroy your ship. English Weller, this is your last warning. Stop now, or we will destroy you.
Let's fly! Let's fly!
The force is so destructive that the very cannons you're firing are flying around the decks. The people are bodies flying everywhere. Utter confusion. Utter destruction. And yet, like a great ship in the vanguard, our blessed Savior went in first. He has gone as a forerunner on our behalf, like a great ship, sailing ship leading the way, taking all the enemy could give, taking a terrible pounding, giving everything he had until he expired on that cross. But never has so great a victory been won. Never has such a story of magnificent triumph been told as that of Jesus Christ, who willingly led the way so that we would have an opportunity for everlasting life. Yes, Jesus suffered terribly for us, but he also rose again and claimed victory over Satan, sin, and death. He entered into the holy place and he bids each one of us, come, follow me. You see, Jesus paid the terrible toll that was required, and he replaced danger with safety. He replaced uncertainty with security. And for each day and for all time, he has replaced despair with hope. Some of you may be asking the same those questions. Well, what do I do? I've been struggling with those things myself. Dave, I've allowed myself to drift away from the truth of the gospel. I've forsaken the anchor and allowed the currents of sinful desire to pull me away from my position in Christ, to be filled with uncertainty about my future. I no longer feel the safety and security of my anchor, Jesus Christ. I feel as if the hope I once had is gone, and now I despair that I may never have hope again. I want to get it back. I want to get back to that firm resting place, but I'm not sure how to do it or if it's even possible. What can I do? Well, I have good news. I have great news. I have marvelous news. This great victory that Jesus won, even if you've drifted or allowed yourself to be dragged away from Jesus Christ, this victory that is able to save you is still effective to restore you. An anchor is dropped in the very deepest depths of the ocean. But our anchor is firmly secured with Christ in heaven. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Listen to the words, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, not some, but all. When we slip away, we need to humble ourselves before God and confess our sins, and he will forgive us. He will restore us. He immediately brings us back into right fellowship with him. There's no penalty box to sit in. There's no 40 lashes. No, there's forgiveness. There's love. There's restoration. Titus 1:2 says, in hope of eternal life, which God, who never lies, promised before the ages began. This morning, brothers and sisters, I urge you, grasp firmly to the anchor of God, the hope of everlasting life, promised by God, provided for by Jesus Christ's death on the cross for us this morning. This morning, will you go with the flow and drift and be dragged to an ineffective end? Or this morning, will you, like Timothy, immerse yourself in the things of God, hold fast to the hope, and stand victorious for God's glory and for your good?
Though they were all of sand, the anchor holds. Though the ship is battered, the anchor holds. Though the sails are torn, sails are torn. I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. Jesus, you are our anchor this morning. We look to you for our strength.